Lynn. I work at UKOLN, and I'm going to talk about some work that we've been doing to basically align the needs of a particular research council with the needs of the university. So to give you a little bit of background, the University of Bath is a top 10 research-intensive institution based in the southwest of the UK. We're a relatively small university. We have fewer than 25,000 staff and students in total. And this is because we don't offer any art subjects. What we do have is a very strong applied science and engineering research focus, and the majority of this research is done in collaboration with industry. And in fact, the partnership with industry and commerce has been written into our university's charter since we were founded back in the 60s, and this presents us with perhaps a unique set of data management challenges. So for the past year, we've been working to develop the human and technical infrastructure that will enable our researchers to manage their data. And we've been doing this as part of a project called Research 360, which is funded by JISC, and that finishes this summer. So I mentioned that we're meeting the needs of a particular research council. That research council is the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council, or EPSRC. And in April 2011, the EPSRC published their new policy framework for research data, and this sets out 9 expectations for data management, covers things such as policy, data publication, metadata, restrictions on access, the usual things. And unusually, in contrast to other funders in the UK, they place the responsibility for compliance on the university rather than individual researchers. They set us 2 deadlines. By May 2012, we had to have a roadmap in place that set out how we planned to achieve full compliance, and the full compliance is required by May 2015. In 2 years' time, if we're found not to be compliant, then we may face sanctions that could include being declared ineligible for future EPSRC funding. Now, as I mentioned, because we have a very strong science and engineering focus, the EPSRC provide the majority of our research funding. So this would have a very severe impact on us as a university, and as such, we're taking these expectations extremely seriously. So the first step in meeting the expectations was to develop our roadmap. We did this May last year. We published our roadmap. It's available to download from our institutional repository, so you can have a look. The roadmap was based on Monash University's hugely influential strategy and strategic plan, particularly the strategic plan part. What we did was we rewrote their objectives so they met, first of all, the needs of the University of Bath. So we aligned them with our research strategy and corporate plans, and we then realigned all of the new objectives with the EPSRC expectations, making sure that the roadmap met the needs of the institution and the funder. We've got 21 objectives, and we've got milestones for delivery of each of them to make sure that we're compliant by 2015, and importantly, the roadmap was ratified by our Vice-Chancellor's group and our university's research committee. And getting this high-level approval has been essential in giving us a mandate to drive through forward data management activities in the university. We've received positive feedback from the EPSRC. They're confident that we're taking their expectations seriously, so we're happy that we've met the first of the 2 deadlines. With regard to implementation, we've already started to implement the roadmap, and many of the activities are underway as part of the Research 360 project. But as I said, that finishes this summer, so we're also writing a business case, and that's going to make sure that resources are available so that we can transition from project-based activities into a sustainable embedded infrastructure in the university. We've already started to put some of this in place. We are putting in place a strategic group that's going to have oversight of data management activities in the university. We've already developed a brand new website, which I would encourage you to go and have a look at. It's receiving some very good feedback, and there's a link on the final slide about that. We're running training workshops, we're developing advocacy resources, guidance resources, and we already have in place secure storage for active data. And that's available for all of our funded researchers, and we're working to develop an institutional data repository that will enable us to publish archived research data. But for the rest of the talk, I'm going to focus on the development of our new data management policy, as that's kind of thrown up a lot of the challenges that we're facing aligning funder and institutional needs. So a data management policy needs to do a number of things. Once it exists, researchers have to be able to comply with the policy. And this is where EPS offscene requirements and bath site requirements align with each other. EPS offscene say that their funded researchers must comply with the university's policy, and the university policy is an enforceable rule. Non-compliance with the policy is considered under disciplinary proceedings. That's great, but the problem is that the researchers can't be expected to comply with the policy if the infrastructure isn't yet in place to enable them to do so. So we're having to be very careful in the wording of our policy. There's a lot of cases where we're saying that they, in addition to that they must do things, they're having to say that they will do something rather than they do something now. So we're sort of hedging our bets a little bit, and we may have to revise that going forward. But that's been okay, EPSRC and BOS expectations align. The scope of the policy is something else that we've been looking at in an awful lot of detail. The policy's got to focus on EPSRC funded researchers, obviously, but they're not our only research group in the university. It has to be applicable to the entire university community, and that includes academics, students, and professional support services. And the issue of students has caused us a lot of trouble. We've had to look very carefully at what their status is within the university. Are their activities classed as study, or are their activities classed as research? And we've had to look at what the intellectual property policy is to work out what we are legitimately allowed to ask our students to do with their data when they get to the end of their studies. We're also highlighted a lot of cases of research that isn't going to be covered by the policy. And this is fine. EPSRC allow us to do this. They have in their policy, they say that there are exemptions allowed under exceptional circumstances. And we found that in every single case, the exceptional circumstances are where research data is generated for use outside the university. A good example of this is contract research. For example, we hire out our microscopy facilities. And in those cases, data is generated for third parties and is taken away by those third parties, and that research data doesn't form part of the digital assets of the institution. Another example is students that are embedded within the university, in industry, and in particular we have a doctoral training centre based in our Centre for Digital Entertainment. And these students, they undertake research. The research is written up as a thesis. We examine the thesis, them, and we provide them with a qualification, which we issue. But for all intents and purposes, the students are employed by commercial companies. They spend the full 4 years of their research working in industry. So we can't realistically ask them or mandate how they're going to manage their data. So rather than put caveats all over the policy, we've decided to exempt them completely. So again, this is something where a situation where the EPSRC expectations align with the expectations of the university, or at least they can work quite well together. Our main difficulty has come with regard to EPSRC's expectations about publication of metadata. And they require that metadata is published within 12 months of data creation, and it must include eventually information about how that data can be accessed, where it's located, and what restrictions there may be of it. That's great. EPSRC would like us to have a very strong statement advocating this. But the problem is that, as I said, a lot of our research is done in collaboration with industry. And that means that there are collaboration agreements already in place. So our new policy can't contradict any of those collaboration agreements, and we've had access to, restricted access to a number of these collaboration agreements, and identified that they don't currently address publication of research data. They do cover publication of research articles, research papers, but not data. And in some cases, they often preclude the free and open sharing of data. So the policy, we can get around this by saying that the policy will apply to new research projects going forward. That gets us around this problem, which means that the role of the policy is that it's got to inform new collaboration agreements. Now, we could say that that means that all new collaboration agreements have to also mandate free and open sharing of data. But a lot of our external partners that we do our research with, the data is extremely commercially sensitive, and we don't want the policy to scare any potential new partners away. So the policy has to act to reassure them that we take, that we understand their requirements, and we take the confidentiality of their commercially sensitive data very seriously. Every collaboration agreement is different, every research partnership is different, so the policy can't mandate one approach to fit everything. So what we can do instead is ensure that publication protocols are going to be set up in future that address not only the publication of articles, but they will address the publication of research data as well. And finally, I want to say the last two slides have taken us the best part of the year to work through, to understand the challenges and to work through addressing them. And the reason it's taken us so long is that development has involved considerable stakeholder consultation. We've talked to legal services, we've talked to the Intellectual Property Department, Freedom of Information, Archive, Research Support Officers. And in many cases, the policy development, we've modified the wording, found that it didn't work, and returned it to its original format. But this hasn't been a wasted exercise. The fact that we've undergone this consultation means that the stakeholders have been engaged with the process. So when the policy is approved later this year, they're going to be more likely to support its implementation. So finally, the roadmap is available to download from our repository. We do have a website, and if you'd like to find out more of the project, there is a blog, or you can contact us directly at the email address at the bottom.